domestic product. Again, this has been important, and it's been important to the growth of the country, but I think it's safe to admit that we have allowed certain aspects of this to get overheated, and probably for too long. I made in March an announcement, an important one, to reduce the number of people that are here temporarily from 7% to 5% over the next 3 years. The Bank of Canada rightly highlighted that a number of the measures that we have taken, while important, were not sufficient in order to address that number and to give people the satisfaction that those numbers were going to come down in that period. Today, along with the announcements that Randy is making, we are announcing further measures, specifically, importantly, with respect to international students, and a few other ones that I will go through here shortly. First, I'd like to say that the measures that we've taken with respect to international students, and again, taking a step back, international students and the postgraduate work permits that come with it, occupy about 50% of the temporary workers that are here in Canada. The programs that Randy administers, about 10-15%, depending how you're counting. So the growth in the international student space, along with the postgraduate work permits that come with them, the spousal permits that come with them, are ones where we owe it to Canadians, and in the context of an economy where the labor market in some areas is constricting, we need to adjust accordingly. I would say that the measures that we've taken up to now are working. You have seen more than anecdotal evidence that there has been an impact on certain rental markets where students are more prevalent. And this is an announcement in advance of the annual level plan that I know a number of you are eager to hear me on, that I will be announcing on November 1st. And integrating for the first time ever a fuller picture of what immigration looks like in our country and what we are projecting for the economy, for Canada, for our social cohesion for the next 3 years. So today I am announcing six additional measures, and I'll go through them in a little bit of detail because I think that's important. Tout d'abord, nous allons réduire la cible des permis d'études délivrés de 10% en 2025 par rapport à 2024, et nous maintiendrons ce niveau pour 2026. Cela signifie que nous visons à délivrer jusqu'à 437 000 permis d'études en 2025 et 2026, ce qui représenterait une baisse d'environ 36 % par rapport à 2023. Deuxièmement, nous allons exempter moins d'étudiants du plafond. Ça veut dire que les gens qui n'étaient pas du plafond qu'on avait annoncé en janvier, c'est-à-dire les gens qui étudient à la maîtrise ou au doctorat, vont être pris en ligne de compte dans ce calcul. For those of you that are looking at the numbers, you will see the number I announced is higher as part of the first measure I'm taking, and that's because of measure two, in which we are carving in master's and PhD programs. So simply put, the international student cap is here to stay. Certains étudiants étrangers sont mieux préparés pour s'intégrer et évidemment réussir au Canada, en particulier les étudiants qui sont titulaires de diplômes d'études supérieures. Ceci répond bien aux besoins du marché du travail canadien, c'est pourquoi nous réservons environ 12 % du plafond à ces étudiants et alignerons le programme de permis de travail de post-diplôme sur nos priorités économiques. Over the next 3 years, and I think this is important, we expect these changes to yield approximately 300,000 fewer study permits. Ça c'est la troisième mesure, à partir du 1er novembre, nous instaurerons de nouvelles exigences en matière de capacité de compétences linguistiques pour les demandeurs de permis de travail post-diplôme alignés sur les exigences du volet de résidence permanente. A Canadian Language Benchmark, CLB, Level 7 for university graduates and CLB 5 for college graduates will be required for anyone applying for post-graduation work permit on or after November 1st of 2024. We know that people that can speak the language are better equipped to succeed in Canadian society. This is a more stringent requirement that I think is very important if we are going to continue the successful story of integration of some of these people into Canadian society. Fourth, for prospective students applying on or after November 1st, post-graduation work permit eligibility will depend on the level of study. Graduates from bachelor's, master's, and doctoral degree programs will remain eligible for a work permit up to 3 years. These graduates are more likely to acquire transferable knowledge and skills and be able to adapt to changing economic circumstances over the long term. Les diplômés des programmes des collèges publics, par contre, pourront obtenir un permis de travail pour une durée maximale de 3 ans seulement si leur domaine d'études est lié à des pénuries sur le marché du travail au Canada. Ces changements feront en sorte que les diplômés disposent de compétences et des occasions de travail nécessaires pour s'intégrer avec succès dans le marché du travail canadien et éventuellement faire la transition peut-être vers la résidence permanente. Over the next three years, we expect these changes to yield approximately 175,000 fewer postgraduate work permits. In the near future, we'll also take further measures to restrict eligibility to spousal open work permits. The fifth measure that I'm announcing today will be to further limit work permit eligibility to spouses of students in doctoral and certain master's select professional programs and certain pilot programs. And over the next 3 years, we expect that measure and these changes to yield approximately 50,000 fewer work permits for the spouses of students groups. And sixth, unrelated to students and postgraduate work permits, we'll also be limiting work permit eligibility to include only spouses of highly skilled specialized workers such as C-suite executives, scientists, engineers, lawyers, professors, and technicians, or of workers in sectors where there are those key labor shortages. Spouses of workers in critical sectors like healthcare, construction will also obviously continue to be eligible for those work permits. As a quantitative measure, again, over the next 3 years, we expect these changes to yield approximately 100,000 fewer work permits. Again, I do stress that these are estimates and obviously will need to be tracked closely. Finalement, en conclusion, comme vous le savez, au cours des dernières années, le contexte en immigration a changé. Évidemment, il y a beaucoup de gens qui tentent et qui menacent d'exploiter, qui exploitent nos programmes d'immigration. À cette fin, j'ai demandé il y a plusieurs mois à mon sous-ministre d'examiner la façon dont les gens, les visas, qui donnent des visas, prennent des décisions dans ce nouveau contexte, y compris les outils, la formation, l'analyse et les procédures utilisées pour approuver les visas de résidents temporaires. En juin de cette année, après avoir discuté avec mes collègues des provinces, après nos discussions internes, j'ai demandé à mon département de scruter à la loupe cette prise de décision. Face au volume qui n'est pas soutenable de gens qui désirent venir au Canada, sachez que arriver au Canada, vouloir venir au Canada est peut-être un rêve, mais c'est un privilège et non un droit. Those measures that we have taken internally to be a little more restrictive on who gets visas, looking at countries where we are seeing people exploiting the visa system, that is to say that those that are claiming for asylum are not legitimate asylum claimants, is a challenge to the system, particularly given the volume of people that are looking to come to Canada. Again, as I said in French, it is a privilege to come to Canada, it is not a right. If you compare the numbers of people that have come in, for example, in one country where we have had some of those challenges from India, we have seen those visas jump down from around 50,000 in January to less than 10,000 in August. Again, these are preliminary numbers, but it is an indicative sign that the measures that we have taken over the summer after discussions with my provincial colleagues are working. There's more work to do. And again, there are a number of measures that we need to take to make sure that when asylum seekers come to this country, they get due process, but that there is no abuse in the system. And it is incumbent on the federal government to act when it controls the levers, particularly at the border. I want to say one final word on what I believe to be, at least at the initial stages, a productive working group with a number of my colleague ministers of labor and immigration, skills training, depending on the title they hold in the province that they represent over the course of the summer. At the Council of the Federation, all of the premiers got together and said that we needed to work as a group to deal with the asylum challenge that this country is facing and that a lot of countries in our position are facing, particularly with respect to the unsustainable numbers of asylum seekers coming into Quebec and coming in to Ontario. All premiers at that time agreed. As a parallel process, had already started the idea of a working group with my colleagues from the provinces to deal with this. We asked ourselves a fundamental question as part of our working group was, what does a fair asylum system look like? That started first and foremost with the responsibility of the federal government to make sure that we are doing our role when it comes to bringing and addressing the number of asylum seekers coming into the country, but also the roles of the provinces that have the effective jurisdiction on some of the services that these asylum seekers seek to do their part. And they all agreed to do so. And with the chairmanship of the Government of Canada and the Government of Nova Scotia, we worked throughout the summer to look at different models of what could this system look like. I'm taking a little bit of time to give you some background because I currently no longer think that that working group is actually helpful. I don't blame the bureaucrats in question. I don't blame the civil servants of our respective provinces and territories for having done their work. I don't blame my colleague ministers for putting their hearts into it. There was a lot of good faith at that table. But sadly, three particularly conservative ministers have stood up, the premiers of Nova Scotia, of New Brunswick and Alberta, and decided to weaponize this working group. They took a theoretical number of asylum seekers based on the last year's number of asylum seekers, divided it up by the population as they would, and assumed that the federal government would impose a number of asylum seekers on them. Let me restate, Ontario and Quebec are doing more than their fair share, and the other provinces need to step up. But there was no point in time where anyone said that the federal government was going to impose thousands of asylum seekers on unprepared provinces. I should probably give you the documents that they themselves leaked because it would probably be quite helpful for your analysis. But this was a productive working group that has been weaponized by three premiers in particular for their re-election or their leadership review. And I think it's really irresponsible. Those provinces come knocking at my door for more immigrants. They are responsible for about 20% of permanent residency numbers through the provincial nominee program. Quebec has the entire control over its permanent residency program based on the Quebec-Canada Accord. And there is a responsible way of doing things. This was not responsible. And they threw their own ministers under the bus. And they've made this productive working group much less productive. It doesn't mean we're giving up. I question the pertinence of this group, given the fact that the documents have been leaked. It's unfortunate. But I do think there was good faith around the table, and we can work on an individual basis with these provinces to see which ones will stand up. There's money on the table. There's over $1 billion that we've committed to making sure that we have a system that makes sense. There are countries in Europe that have a system that makes sense. And indeed, the European Union has a system that, while they are facing different challenges than us, at least has some semblance of sense. So this is about a bunch of premiers who decided to weaponize the issue. Unfortunately, it's undermined the credibility of this committee and obviously considering dissolving it. That's the last of the formal part of my presentation, but Randy and I are pleased to take your questions, which I'm sure you have a few of. Thank you.
Thank you, ministers. Yeah, we'll turn to the question and answer portion.